ඇතිමතුන් කැටුව ආමවපියන් දරුවන් අයිමිවී සදාසෝගිනි කඳක දැවිමින් වැළපෙමින් රටම අන්දය කොළුය බිහිරිය මන්දයි සුසානය මැද සොහොන් කඳු මත වැළපෙති ස්වාමිවරු සිය බිරිඳ දරුවන් අහිමි වූ කුරිරු ඝාතක රැළම නිදහස් සුව විඳි නොලැබ දඬුවම් රටට පිටුපා සිනාසි
Today is the 21st of April 2021. On a fateful day like today, 2 years ago, many Sri Lankans, mostly Christian devotees, left their homes clad in the best attire to celebrate Easter Sunday, never to return home. A series of coordinated attacks carried out by a group of hateful souls rocked our nation to its core, causing an immense loss of life. 2 years down the line, we as a nation continue to seek for answers. We continue to seek for justice for those responsible for that heinous crime while remembering the innocent souls who pay the ultimate price at the hands of a vengeful few. Good evening to you. You are watching Primetime News. I'm Chaturanga Appuarachchi. Let's first take a look at the headlines.
Delay in revealing the truth behind the April 21st attacks endangers the entire nation. A statement from Malcolm Cardinal Ranjit. Statement made by MP Harin Fernando heats up Parliament. A ship transporting uranium to be used in nuclear power plants docks at the Hambantota port. Venerable Alle Gunawansathera says, the Port City Economic Commission bill was drafted with a slave mentality and urges the government to draft a fresh proposal.
Our sign language interpreter for the day is Brian Cruz. Let's now take a look at the stories in detail. A mass is held at the St. Anthony's Shrine in Kochikade in remembrance of those who lost their lives in the April 21st attacks 2 years ago.
A 2-minute silence was observed island-wide at 8:45 a.m. in remembrance of those who were injured and lost their lives in the April 21st attacks 2 years ago. Archbishop of Colombo, His Eminence Malcolm Cardinal Ranjit, conducted a mass in remembrance of the victims at the St. Anthony's Shrine in Kochikade. The bells tolled at the church at 8:47 a.m. while candles were lit in remembrance of the fallen victims.
To light a candle.
Religious leaders of all faiths and those who suffered injuries following the April 21st attacks visited the church to engage in religious observances. The ambassadors and high commissioners of several countries were also present at the occasion.
We are suspicious that hundreds of terrorists who pledged their allegiance to the group that carried out the bombings while shattering the lives of several people are roaming at large in the society. We are also suspicious that they might fulfill their allegiance at any moment by carrying out an attack at any other religious place of worship such as temples and kovils. It is the government's responsibility to wipe out such fears. Terrorists come in many forms. One form includes feeding harmful meals to the people. The people have lost their faith in the Sri Lanka standard symbol. Another form of terrorism is immorality. This was shown in Parliament yesterday. It's the government's responsibility to wipe out all forms of terrorism. We pray for those who lost their lives during the ruthless attacks on Easter Sunday. We use this opportunity to convey our deepest condolences to those who lost their lives, their families, and those who were injured in the attacks. I wish to state that Islam does not encourage these ruthless attacks, even to the slightest extent. These Muslim burial grounds did not accept the remains of Zahran and those who were linked to the horrific bombings. We rejected them. We gave their remains to the army to be disposed even at sea. They are not believers of the Islamic faith.
On this second commemoration of the Easter Sunday tragedy, I bring you words of consolation from the Holy Father, Pope Francis. He gives his apostolic blessing to you and your families, and particularly the families of the victims of the attack. Jesus prayed from the cross for those who persecuted and killed him, while the Church prays and encourages justice to take its rightful course. It also forgives the culprits and implores the repentance of those still harboring similar malice. Revenge never truly satisfies victims. Revenge resolves nothing.
While there is a mechanism under which investigations into other crimes are being carried out in a transparent and an efficient manner, and suspects are being brought before the law, we express our regret to see that the government at the time and the present government are making decisions based on various political motives. It is clear that there is a heavy political objective behind this conduct. The relevant officials have failed to conduct an impartial and fully fledged investigation into this incident. We believe this is because the political apparatus is ridden by corrupt and selfish individuals. We emphasize that steps must be taken swiftly to implement the recommendations of the Presidential Commission to wipe out terrorism and to ban schools and institutions that propagate Wahhabism in the country. We have also drawn our attention towards the matters raised in Parliament over the April 21st attacks. While considering the debate on the facts surrounding the April 21st attacks, we wish to state that senior officials in the government who have found themselves in the midst of controversial allegations must respond to those matters in question. Against a backdrop in which cases have not been filed against any individual, although it has been 2 years since the bombings, I wish to tell all the affected families and my fellow Sri Lankan brothers and sisters that we will not stop our struggle until justice is served on behalf of those who have been affected by the attacks.
Religious observances were also held at the St. Sebastian's Church in Katuapitiya and the Zion Church in Batiklo. Special security plans were in operation surrounding churches as today marked 2 years since the day of the attacks. Meanwhile, a special demonstration is organized today demanding justice over the April 21st attacks. The demonstration that commenced from the Maristella College in Igambo proceeded towards the St. Sebastian's Church in Katuapitiya. A special security plan was implemented at Catholic churches across the country today, which marks 2 years since the April 21st attacks.
Meanwhile, Prime Minister Mahinda Rajapaksa made a special statement in Parliament today in remembrance of the victims of the April 21st attack.
The Attorney General has been directed to take legal action based on the report and other documents prepared based on the information disclosed at the Commission. Although we do not intend to intervene in judicial proceedings, I would like to say that the government is ready to provide any assistance to make the proceedings successful. In addition to the Commission, His Excellency the President has facilitated the investigations of the Criminal Investigations Department and the Terrorism Investigation Division to be carried out independently. We are confident that at the end of these investigations, the respective departments will take action in the future. Innocent people had to pay the price for the criminal negligence and evasion of duties of the previous government who interfered with national security, mixing it with their own political activities. Even today, those involved are trying to spread various lies, influencing investigations and diverting public attention. We are disappointed about that.
A minute of silence was observed following the statement to commemorate those killed and injured as a result of the attack. Opposition MPs were clad in black in parliamentary chambers today, while government ministers and MPs wore black armbands.
Tensions flared in Parliament today while ruling party MPs opposed the statement made by MP Harin Fernando yesterday on serving justice to those responsible for the April 21st attacks.
එතකොට පොඩි සාරාන් මාතලේ පොඩි සාරාන් එයාගෙන හරින්න ඇව්වේ ඒවට උත්තර දෙනවා වෙනුවට හරින්ට ගහනවා ඒ නිසා ඒක නෙමෙයි වෙන්න ඕනේ ඒ නිසා පැහැදිලිව අපි කියනවා බොස් කවුද කියලා අපිට මේ කරු සභාවට කියන්න
These people could not prevent the attacks and instead they are alleging us. It is because you behaved in the same manner when you were in power that this tragedy took place. If you accuse us to have covered up intelligence reports, hiding behind our parliamentary privileges, please go and file a complaint with the police. Please do not politicize the lives lost from the April 21st attacks. We are carrying out investigations. Not only that, Honorable Speaker, we will punish the perpetrators behind the attacks as well.
As the opposition, we are disappointed to share this parliamentary complex alongside the ruling faction today because the opposition has brought boats to parliament violating parliamentary laws and celebrating Zaharan on the day the entire nation is lamenting.
Zaharan ma ada semerua nisa api vipaksya kete ada kanagadu no me parliament we tamun nasrat ke wadi lain nek.
Itu malah tamai last year.
They were the ones who were prepared to carry out this protest. You can find the banners and slogans they brought if you look under their tables. It is you who reminisced Zaharan wearing black attire. Because their attempts proved futile, now they are slinging mud at the government.
We did not have any boards, nor were we ready to hold any boards today. Like the Archbishop said, we observed 2 minutes of silence wearing black in Parliament today. But you came and celebrated Zaharan.
The parliament police have taken various material brought by the opposition into their custody. I ask the speaker to carry out an investigation into this attempt to exert violence in parliament.
Honorable speaker, the leader of the house says that the parliament police have taken various material we brought to parliament into their custody.
2019 4වෙනි මාසයේ 26 වෙනිදා
The military intelligence unit arrests a suspect on the 26th of April 2019 from Panadura. Following interrogations, he was handed over to DID officials to continue the proceedings. Those officials unraveled a lot of information from that suspect. The TID had filed charges against him, citing that he had close ties with Zahran and had held lectures with him. But on the 18th of September last year, the Attorney General had sent a letter to the TID requesting his release. How can that happen? This person in question had filed a fundamental rights petition with the Supreme Court. In that fundamental rights application, he had accepted that he operated as an informant to the military intelligence units. How can that happen? That is why we urge to find out who is the invisible force behind this. Who gave instructions to the Attorney General to release this suspect? The government is trying to cover this up. We would like to remind that it was through Zahran that this government had the strength to come into power.
MP
Manusha Nanayakkara, in a lengthy explanation yesterday, said that a person called the boss is very displeased about what is transpiring. Who is this boss? Explain who that is without shouting at other things. Abu Bakr, who was the traffic OIC of Kattankudi, who took Sara in his vehicle, is still in custody. Who gave instructions to Abu Bakr to provide transport to Sara to go to India? None of these questions were answered. A constant question we ask is as to what happened to Sara. He was born in Trivandrum, Kerala on the 21st of June 1973. He comes to Sri Lanka on visa for 10 years in 2014 to mow lawns. After a few weeks of his arrest, he dies in hospital. Why did he die? None of that information has surfaced. Before that, an Indian national who visited Namal Kumar's residence was deported on the basis saying he has gone mad. We have received information that while all of this was taking place, the person named Boss was in India. It is reported that he has gone to India on scholarship. Are these incidents connected? Please reveal this to the public.
The Janata Vimukti Peramuna filed a complaint with the police headquarters today. This was against the removal of its posters reminding the public of the April 21st attacks that occurred 2 years ago. Janata Vimukti Peramuna released a video footage relating to this matter to the media today.
What has Sarath Veerasekara done? They have chosen the mastermind instead of identifying him.
The government reversed the April 21st attacks and vowed to bring the perpetrators to justice. By today, Serbian justice has become a hurtful fact for them. It has been 2 years since the attacks. The masterminds are still at large. Serve justice, it is a fair request. However, the government deployed police officers in Mufti to rip off posters pasted around the city of Colombo. Asking the government for justice today has become a hurtful request for them at present.
විඳිතයන්ට යුක්ති ඉටු කරනු කියලා ඉල්ලීම මහා මොලකරුවන් නිදැල්ල කියලා ප්‍රකාශ කිරීම අද ආණ්ඩුවට ප්‍රධාන රිදුම් දෙන කාරණා බවට පත් වී තිබෙනවා.
Meanwhile, Venerable Omal P. Sobhithathero lodged a complaint at the Criminal Investigations Department today.
ලෝක මුස්ලිම් ලීගයේ
On the 30th of July 2019, the president of the World Muslim League, Mohammed bin Abdullah, presented a cash donation to the then president, Maithripala Sirisena. It was $5 million. $5 million in Sri Lankan rupees is equivalent to 1 billion. This check was donated to the former president at a public meeting at the Nelumpukuna Theatre in Colombo. How the money that was donated was used is still unknown. We asked Cardinal Malcolm Ranjith and he says that so far no such assistance has been received from anyone. Former Governor Muzamil also shared similar sentiments. So what has happened to this money? We came here today to find a solution to this problem. Is this going to fall into the hands of these criminals again? They are trying to hide the real evidence to cover up these crimes. So we have great doubts as citizens of this country. We need answers.
The Ministry of Health has observed a sharp spike in the number of COVID-19 patients being admitted to ICUs at hospitals following an increase in the infection rate of COVID-19 in the country. Issuing a media release, the Health Promotion Bureau said that a new strain of COVID-19 has also been discovered from the country over the past few days. The release has called on the general public to strictly follow health guidelines once more by limiting mobility while supporting to stop the spread of COVID-19 in the country. 5 COVID-19 related deaths were reported yesterday, while 367 COVID-19 patients were identified. 22 of them are returnees from foreign nations. The total number of COVID-19 patients in the island since the onset of the virus currently stands at 97,472.
The next 3 weeks to 1 month will be a crucial period for us because many strains continue to originate from various nations. Many Sri Lankan returnees tested positive for the virus once they are tested here. An increase in the spread of the virus has been observed based on the manner the society acted in the recent past.
Main sponsor.
Cargills Online, delivering groceries on time, always.
Do your online shopping now with sambole.lk to get it home delivered or pick up on your way.
Sambole.lk.
Bellboy's got you covered. Download Bellboy today to get all your household appliance fixing and repairs done. Now available on Android and iOS.
Welcome back to the news. A Chinese vessel carrying radioactive uranium used for nuclear power plants had arrived at the port of Hambantota. Director General of Atomic Energy Regulatory Council of Sri Lanka, Anil Ranjit, said that the ship was ordered to be removed from the port. However, the Navy says the vessel is still anchored in the outer harbour.
The leader of the opposition raised questions surrounding the vessel in Parliament today, following which responsible authorities responded. The vessel, named BBC Naples, en route to the port of Shanghai in China from Rotterdam in the Netherlands, had arrived at the port of Hambantota at around 9 p.m. last night. The vessel had docked at the port of Hambantota for an urgent mechanical requirement. The Atomic Energy Regulatory Commission of Sri Lanka stated the vessel contained uranium used for nuclear power plants, adding the document related to the vessel had not been prepared accurately by the local agent. If the radioactive material is coming to Sri Lanka, we need to get permission from the Atomic Energy Regulatory Council, be it on a ship or an aircraft. In this case, the ship's local agent did not declare that there was radioactive material on board. What was not declared was the fact that there was dangerous cargo. That's why the harbour master's approval has been given. But the harbour master later discovered that it had nuclear material on board. It was a shipment that arrived without our approval, so I told them to remove it from our port immediately.
ෂිප්මන්ට් එකක් ෂිප් කරන්න එක මම කිව්වා වහාම මේ අපේ බරයෙන් ඒක හයිඩ් කරගන්න.
The Hambantota International Port Group issued a statement this afternoon confirming the presence of uranium hexafluoride radioactive material in the cargo ship. They said that the local agent of the vessel had not informed the Sri Lanka Ports Authority or the Hambantota Port Authority in advance about the relevant stock of toxic chemicals. The Hambantota International Ports Group stated that the presence of uranium hexafluoride radioactive material in the ship has been confirmed during an investigation carried out by the Sri Lanka Ports Authority and the Sri Lanka Navy. Accordingly, the vessel was immediately ordered to be removed from the Hambantota port, and based on the submissions made by the ship's local agent, the Sri Lanka Ports Authority, the Navy and the Sri Lanka Customs officials had approved the documents necessary for the ship's repair work. It further states that the ship and Sri Lanka Customs have been monitoring the ship since its entry into the Hambantota port, and no cargo of the ship have been unloaded to the premises of the Hambantota International Port. Meanwhile, State Minister of Solar, Wind and Hydropower Generation Projects Development, Duminda Dissanayake, also issued a statement regarding the incident this afternoon. It states it would seek legal action against Wilhelmsen Meridian Navigation Limited, the ship's local agent, for violating the provisions of the Atomic Energy Act of Sri Lanka.
The petitions regarding the Colombo Port City Economic Commission Bill were heard in the Supreme Court today, while reports were received regarding the incident where the ship carrying a radioactive material to China arrived at the Hambantota port. President's Counsel Ramesh De Silva appeared for Secretary to the President P.B. Jayasundara, who has petitioned as an intermediary party. He stated that as China is a long-standing friend of our country, no one should be pessimistic about the Chinese taking over the management of the Colombo Port City Economic Zone. The President's Council stated that this is something that Sri Lankans can be happy about to a certain extent. President's Counsel Ramesh De Silva stated that some lawyers were accusing the Colombo Port City Economic Zone of being a Chinese colony, adding that it was somewhat ridiculous to be inside the Supreme Court complex built and donated by the Chinese government. He emphasized that since all members of the commission are appointed by the President of Sri Lanka, it would not violate the constitution of the country in any way. Justice Priyanta Jayawardena asked President's Counsel Ramesh De Silva whether he accepts that certain provisions of the bill appears to threaten the unitary status of the country and is in violation of the constitution. The President's Counsel then answered that he believes that to be the case.
Meanwhile, a discussion took place in the House regarding an SMS sent to members of Parliament to engage in an inspection tour of the Colombo Port City. An SMS has been sent by the Parliament for MPs to engage in an inspection tour of the port city conducted by the Chinese embassy. A similar opportunity was afforded to us during the good governance regime, but it was conducted by the Urban Development Authority. Why is the Chinese embassy conducting the tour on a land which we claim to own? Please look into this matter.
What the member raising is totally irrelevant to the debate that is has already right. Begun.
We'll continue with the debate.
Honorable Speaker, the leader of the House says this is irrelevant to the debate. Who is sending these messages?
The chairman of the National Movement to Protect the Nation, Venerable Alle Gunawansa Thera, has said the Colombo Port City Economic Commission bill has been prepared with a slave mentality. The Thera noted, the bill paves the way for a large-scale corruption involving the exploitation of a vast expanse of land. He added, the laws have been drafted in a manner that provides more benefits to the investors. The statement issued by Venerable Alle Gunawansa Thera observed that the land-related provisions outlined in the bill allows entities to enjoy benefits that go beyond selling these lands. He raised suspicion whether the bill has been drafted similar to the MCC and Singapore free trade agreements by officials based on the whims and fancies of foreign entities to sabotage the port city project. Accordingly, Venerable Alle Gunawansa Thera has requested the President to put forth a new bill that will allow Sri Lanka to reap several benefits through the Port City project.
Opposition parliamentarian Buddhika Pathirana made revelations regarding serious fraudulent acts which were taking place in Parliament yesterday.
What they are trying to do anew is to paste a sticker on imported alcohol bottles of foreign brands and to paste another sticker on local alcohol bottles. Also to paste a sticker on foreign alcohol bottles that are manufactured here. Don't ask me how I am able to present this information to the house. I will now show you a bottle that has been stickered in this manner. It has a barcode on it. When you scan the barcode with our phones, the message you get states that there is no information relevant to this. On the occasion this proposal came up in 2016, the State Printing Corporation put forward a proposal, but then it went to an Indian firm. During the good governance government of 2017, they won the tender again, and they have continued their unethical practices by joining hands with the officials and politicians to continue the fraud that took place during that time. The government should find out whether those officials are continuing to do so or not. This either has to happen with the knowledge of Prime Minister Mahinda Rajapaksa or the State Minister of Finance Ajit Niwad Kabral. All these things are happening unbeknownst to them. This has been given to the Indian firm MSP. The serious issue is that when issues surrounding the sticker are raised, they give dubious alternatives such as a marking paper. If a sticker costs 2 rupees each, these alternatives cost just 25 cents. The director of this company, Pratap Singh, as well as the general manager of the regulatory authority named the Kenya Bureau, were arrested for a similar scam this company has committed in Kenya.
అతను దాహక అత్తడంగోట అరగిన హీరో బారట పట్టుకెళ్ళ తీనో మే అపిట స్టికర్ దిన ఆయదనే కెన్యా వేదిక రూపు అంచావక్ సంబంధి.
The Consumer Affairs Authority has informed Litrogas Lanka Limited to withdraw a new product, citing that it misleads the consumer.
On the 9th of April, Litrogas Lanka Limited had informed the Consumer Affairs Authority that it would be introducing a new 18-liter gas cylinder to the market. The letter confusingly claims that the product does not fall under Section 18 of the Consumer Affairs Authority Act, which identifies goods essential for the people. Litrogas Lanka has regularly sold 12.5-kilogram cylinders with a quantity of 25 liters at the cost of 1,495 rupees. The latest product, sold at 1,395 rupees, reduces the quantity in the 12.5-kilogram cylinder to 18 liters. Although the selling price of the product has been reduced by 100 rupees, officials say that the company is likely to make an additional profit of 317 rupees per cylinder by reducing the quantity. Investigations carried out by the Consumer Affairs Authority have revealed that the weight of the cylinder has been erased and omitted in the new product. This indicates that the new product is nothing other than the old 12.5-kilogram cylinder with the reduced quantity of gas. Removing or tampering with a label on a product is an offence under the Consumer Affairs Authority Act. Against such a backdrop, the Consumer Affairs Authority has directed Litrogas Lanka to recall the new product and to ensure that regular stocks of 12.5-kilogram cylinders are available in the market.
The volatility of the Sri Lankan rupee against the US dollar has become a main focal point in the country at present. On the 15th of April this year, the rupee hit an all-time low of 204 rupees and 6 cents against the US dollar before making a slight recovery, only to weaken once more yesterday.
Speaking on the matter in Parliament yesterday, opposition MP Dr. Harsha De Silva alleged the government had sold $67 million US dollars from the $500 million US dollar loan obtained from China in the foreign exchange market. The government boasted to us saying Sri Lanka received a loan worth $500 million US dollars from China. They gallantly announced that the rupee was strengthening. I have with me a statement issued by a renowned research organization.
According to market sources, the rupee appreciated 4% since 16th April 2021, largely due to CBSL selling $65 million on the 19th of April. Within Prakash Sinha, usual equivalent to 1 month sales to the forex market.
What does this mean? $67 million US dollars of the $500 million has been sold in the foreign exchange market. What is happening here is they are misleading the public, saying that the rupee is strengthening, inflation is reducing, and the economy is moving forward. What is happening in actual fact is the total opposite.
What I'm trying to say, Honorable Chairman, is we have been taken on a ride by this government.
Meanwhile, the dollar too languished earlier today, hovering just about a 7-week low with subdued US bond yields, reducing the currency's yield appeal. The dollar index, which tracks the US currency against six major peers, was at 91.196 early in the Asian trading day after slumping as low as 90.856 on Tuesday for the first time
since the 3rd of March. It has declined 2.2% so far this month. According to analysts, declines in US yields and the dollar in April have come as evidence mounted that the Fed would be slower in tightening monetary policy than it had appeared to the market.
On to some tragic international news. At least 22 COVID-19 patients have died in a hospital in India after they lost oxygen supply due to a leak.
The incident occurred today while an oxygen tanker was refilling a storage tank at the Zakir Hussain Hospital in Nashik City. It's unclear how the accident happened and why it interrupted supply to patients. But officials said there was no oxygen flowing to ventilators for about 30 minutes, leading to the deaths. The city's municipal commissioner said that investigations are currently underway. The hospital had called in tankers after it had begun to run out of oxygen. Hospitals across the country are struggling to keep oxygen supply going amid soaring demand.
We leave you tonight with the remarks expressed by a farmer over the difficulties posed by the aquatic weed identified as water hyacinth in the Parakrama Samudraya in Polonnaruwa. Our sign language interpreter for the day has been Brian Cruz. I am Satharang Hapuarachi. Thank you very much for watching. Take care.
The epilogue.
They said that they will construct and refurbish 10,000 wavers. They must pay attention to that. They must focus on the issues surrounding wavers that are of importance to farmers. Officials who are idling will not look into these matters. They won't pay attention as well. They will only act before the media.
The epilogue.